The image of a sacred flower, a divine rose from heaven's own garden, blooming in the shadows of our world, is a portrait of hope and comfort. When translated into music, it becomes a song that speaks to our deepest needs for restoration and redemption. It sings to us of gardens lost to sin and despair. It reveals to us a lonely garden where ancient olive trees stand silent witness to the suffering of the Savior. It sings of a garden meant for death suddenly springing to life in a shower of joyful alleluias. It is God's tender love song reminding us all that we are children of the garden. Finally, its heart, it is the music of one truly perfect rose who, choosing grace, died for his beloved thorns. At the dawn of creation, a beautiful garden bloomed in the land of Eden, planted by God himself. The sparkling river that flowed through it watered the plants and trees that grew there. In this garden, God placed his children to care for it and to live peacefully alongside him forever. But because they brought sin into the paradise, God banished them from Eden and sent them into the wilderness to work the land. And God cursed the ground and caused it to bear thorns and thistles, yielding food only through man's physical toil and hard labor. Though they no longer lived with him in the perfection of Eden, God never left his children. He saw their struggles and heard their cries. And the Lord said, I will restore the land. I will cause rivers to flow on the barren hills and springs within the valleys. I will turn the desert into pools of water. The dry earth will be glad, and the wilderness will rejoice and burst into bloom once more like a glorious garden. Said, "The poor and needy cry out. Let those who thirst come, and I will give them water. Their deserts will be like Eden, and their wasteland like a garden of joy. Thanksgiving and the sound of singing will once again be heard in Zion."
Sinners, poor and
the land became fruitful. He watched over it and watered it continually with his blessing. No longer was the land called desolate. In what had once been a dry desert, God's perfect blossom, the Rose of Sharon, began to grow. Out of the slumbering earth, the slender stem took root. Those who were weary from their labors found rest in this new promise of life, their parched spirits renewed by the water that sustained it. Like a fragrance permeating the air, news of the rose spread quickly wherever he went. By the time he reached the city of Jerusalem, crowds began to line the path, waving palms and laying branches before him. Hosannas rang through the narrow streets as the people pressed closer to catch a glimpse of the one named Jesus, the one they call Messiah.
Sing aloud, Hosanna, glory to God.
Although large crowds followed the rose, the piercing eyes of his heart always saw the individual in need. The disciples at times rebuked the clamoring throngs, but the rose was filled with compassion. He lovingly revived the weary, healed the broken, and breathed life into the dead. With a gift for teaching truths, he summed up his ministry with two basic commandments: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Touched by his wisdom and humility, the flower of hope had begun to bloom in the hearts of the people.
Gentle in spirit.
Despite the blossoming admiration of the people, seeds of discontent had been sown among the religious and political leaders. Realizing that his popularity was growing, the chief priests plotted to uproot the rose. His remaining days short, he retreated to a moonlit garden for solace. Although he longed to have the bitter cup of sacrifice removed, he prayed for his father's will to be accomplished. And there, among the trees and flowers, the noble rose bent over in sorrow and wept.
Nice.
That evening, the temple guard arrested Jesus and led him to the high priest for questioning. At daybreak, he was taken before Pilate, who was the Roman governor. Knowing that the priests acted out of envy, Pilate planned to punish Jesus to satisfy them and then release him. Now it was the custom at the Passover to release a prisoner of the people's choosing. Pilate, therefore, put the matter before the people. Choose Jesus, who had committed no crime, or choose Barabbas, an obviously dangerous criminal, who was in prison for murder. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd's emotions. The welcoming cries of Hosanna were now faded, and the streets echoed with shouts of Give us Barabbas. Astounded, Pilate asked, And what shall I do with the one called Jesus? To which the frenzied mob thundered, Crucify him. Inside the praetorium, Jesus was stripped and mocked. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and placed it on his head, put a purple robe on him, and struck him repeatedly. When they were finished, they put his own clothes on him and led him away to be crucified. Outside the city, they nailed the rose to a cross and planted it on a hill called Calvary. Bore no signs of beauty. He was a sight to be pitied, turned away from. His head, still adorned by a crown of thorns, bled, the drops falling like crimson petals upon the ground. Outwardly stripped of his dignity, with great effort, he summoned his fading strength and said,
"Father, forgive them, for they know not, they do not understand what they are doing." The last scarlet petal fell, and the rose lay twisted and dead within the cruel embrace of the thorns.
Thank you.
Those who loved the rose placed him in a garden tomb. After the Sabbath, they came to anoint his wounded body with fragrant spices and ointments. But the stone that sealed the tomb had been rolled aside. Peering within, they found his body gone and feared that it had been stolen. Sitting inside the tomb were angels who asked them, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen as he said. Go quickly and tell his disciples." With great joy, they shared the miraculous news. Death had given birth to life. From the path that led out of Eden to Gethsemane, and finally a garden tomb, God's perfect paradise was restored. The Rose of Sharon blooms once more, filling our hearts and lives with the sweet fragrance of forgiveness, that we might live with God in the garden forever.